Hey folks, John Belinsky here from See Me for Life, and our whole goal is to help you maximize your mind. When people say, hey, what do you do at See Me for Life? I say, well, we simply teach medicine. And that's what we do. We teach medicine simply, and that's what the focus is of this EKG program. Now, I've taught EKG interpretation for 10 years at PA programs and at conferences all over the United States. I've taught a lot of board review and clinical classes on reviewing 12-lead EKGs. And I'm a clinician. I'm in the trenches taking care of these people, so it's critically important that I'm good at it and I teach that knowledge to others. It's my passion and my calling. But what I've found through these Facebook pages and conferences is there's a gap. There's a gap between clinical understanding and basic fundamentals. Now, what happens often, and it's very similar to acid-base, people will miss a gap early and then they'll never be able to understand the advanced concepts. Now, I do a lot of teaching of intermediate and advanced 12-lead EKG interpretation, but I've forgot some of you folks. I've forgot a tremendous number of people, like the dermatology PAs, orthopedic PAs, psychiatry PAs, that for their boards, they need to know this stuff. Maybe clinically it's not applicable, but they need to know it for their board. So what I'm doing with this multi-part program is to teach what I taught at PA schools. We're going to start from scratch. We're going to start with some very basic. So what I'm going to challenge you to do is be engaged. Be engaged with every one of these posts on the Facebook page. It's going to allow you to grow. And over the 1 month period of time, you're going to really get a solid fundamental knowledge of EKGs that's real tangible. One thing I promise you this is, I'm not going to go into a bunch of theoretical crap. I'm going to teach you what you need to know. Now, there's a graph on learning that goes like this, where on the first part of this parabola is simplicity. On the top is complexity. And when you come down to the other end, it's simplicity again. What I'm going to do is teach simplicity on the other side of complexity. I'm going to cut out all the crap, Einthoven's triangle and summation vectors. And I'm going to try to teach you what you really need to know to really have an understanding of EKG. So buckle your seatbelts, be engaged. Do not passively watch these videos, folks. Be engaged on the social media platform. Be engaged. Ask questions. Really use this time to grow in knowledge on 12-lead EKGs. First and foremost, if you look at the picture in front of you, we have pink, orange, yellow, green, blue. Pink is the P wave. We're going to talk about that, but that represents atrial depolarization or the atrium contracting. Now, you need to know anatomy physiology to understand 12-lead EKGs, and I'm assuming you're coming into this with that. You have a functional understanding of anatomy physiology, that you know that there's a left atrium and a right atrium. The P wave typically represents the left atrium depolarizing, but you can consider them as both. So both of the top parts of the heart are contracting. The PR segment is an electrical component. It's the timing from the electricity going from the SA node to the AV node. So what it's doing is it's measuring speed, okay? The yellow is the QRS complex. That's the left ventricle depolarizing or contracting. First off, make sure you understand that the terms depolarization and contraction are one and the same. So if I say atrial depolarization, your mind should say, hey, the top of the heart is beating. The ST segment starts the recharging phenomenon of the heart to a huge degree, ladies and gentlemen. That green segment in front of you, that is what you're going to need to isolate to tell if the patient's having an ischemia or an infarction. ST segment elevation or depression. And the blue is ventricular repolarization or recharging. To a huge degree, ventricular repolarization has to do with potassium, because that's where we're going to look to see if the patient's hyperkalemic or hypokalemic is that T wave. So first and foremost, I'm painting the picture of pink, orange, yellow, green, and blue. Now, when it comes to the EKG itself, you're going to put a bunch of stickers on the patient. You're going to put stickers across the chest and on the arms and legs. And quite frankly, don't tell anybody this. Don't tell anybody this, okay? I don't know how to put the stickers on, okay? I've been taught, but I have wonderful nursing staff and nurses aides who are masters at it, so I defer to their good judgment. But if someone gave me a bunch of stickers and said, put the stickers on, I would struggle. You don't need to know that for 12-lead EKG interpretation or really rhythm strip interpretation, but know that what we're doing is, and this is fascinating to me, we're putting these stickies on people, we're measuring the electrical currents through the heart, and literally telling information if they're going to live or die. It's fascinating to me. So we're going to put a bunch of stickers on their chest to help us get this information. Now, on your 12-lead, you have two different ways to get information. You either have a 12-lead EKG or you have a rhythm strip. 12-lead EKG rhythm strip. And there's three different major units that you can do. 12-lead gives you a 12-lead EKG. Beautiful. That's what we're going to talk about in the second half of this month. Or we can put them on a monitor, which just, you know, a telemetry monitor. You put stickers on them, and you can watch their heart rhythm. Or we have the monitor in emergency room. We have a monitor in that we can actively engage with that allows us to defibrillate and cardiovert. So the units that we use in emergency room can do four things, ladies and gentlemen. They can monitor a patient, just keep an eye on their rhythm. We can pace them, and we do transcutaneous pacing of anybody who's got a symptomatic bradycardia that does not respond to medicines. Or we can shock them in one of two ways. We can do a synchronized cardioversion or an unsynchronized cardioversion, or also known as defibrillation. So we can shock them in one of two ways, which we will talk about in later chapters. Synchronized cardioversion or unsynchronized defibrillation. The electrodes go on the patient, arms, legs, across their thorax. From that, we get the 12-lead EKG information. Once again, I'm not real strong in telling where those stickers go, and I don't feel you necessarily need to know that. Now, know that on tests, on the PA boards, on any boards, you will get a perfect EKG. There won't be artifact, okay? But that's not life. Life is artifact. There's a whole bunch of things that are going to throw off your 12-lead EKG. So you can have unwanted jittering or interference on the EKG tracing that throws off how you see things. That can be very confusing to someone new. What are four kinds of artifacts? We can have somatic tremors, baseline sway, 60-cycle interference, broken recording, which looks like this. Somatic tremor is someone that's shaking, whether they have Parkinson's or they're rigoring from a fever or they're just cold. So when you see an abnormal beats that look like the rhythm strip in front of you, that represents somatic tremor. You can have a swavy baseline, and to a huge degree that has to do with how the patient moves or breathes. Something was fascinating. When I was in the Marine Corps, we fired a missile called the Dragon. And it was a shoulder-fired missile that was guided by a wire. And on the missile itself, it had rockets. So you put your target in the crosshairs of the scope. And if you follow the target with the crosshairs, it'll send impulses to the missile to move it. It's a guided missile, right? And one thing that would happen often on the firing range was someone would line up on a target, fire it, and right before it hit the target, they would breathe and go, and then the missile would go right over top. Okay, that's a baseline sway, similar to the artifact that you're seeing in front of you. 60-cycle interference shows this real thick, goofy baseline that has to do with electrical currents. And that's when you really need to check your leads and make sure everything is plugged in tight. The last one is just a broken recording where it typically represents a lead falling off. So if you see any of these interferences, ladies and gentlemen, just check your equipment and make sure that if you don't have a good reading, have it redone. Get some help, but if you don't have a solid bit of information, your interpretation is going to be drastically off. Now, know that asystole can masquerade as artifact. So the first step in anybody in cardiac arrest with asystole is confirm it in two leads, because you don't want to call someone asystole when maybe they're in VTAC or VFib, where we can actually do defibrillation and possibly bring them back to life. Now, toothbrush tachycardia is this. I remember when I'm first on a telemetry wing, about 15 years ago, I'm sitting there and the monitors go off, and I see VTAC, and I'm like, but the nurses aren't moving. They're not even acknowledging this. I think I'm the only person seeing this tachycardia, and I'm like, hey guys, I want to save the day, and I finally go to one of the nurses. I'm like, don't you see this VTAC there? And she looks at it and she goes, kind of looks like he's brushing his teeth. And I'm like, get out of here. So I stormed the room. Yeah, he was brushing his teeth. Okay. Any rhythmic motion that the patient is doing will present like tachycardia. Any rhythmic motion that a patient is doing can present just like this, toothbrush tachycardia. Or I had a nurse say she found some male patients in compromising positions because there was the artifact of tachycardia going on. So she's always a little bit hesitant of rushing in the room at times with toothbrush tachycardia. Now, true ventricular tachycardia, looks like the rhythm in front of you. We're going to talk about that in some of the later chapters, but you have to know how to identify ventricular tachycardia. That's a life or death rhythm. That's what I call a sight rhythm, where, sure, we'll talk about the criteria to identify it, but I need you to look at it and just know it like the back of your hand, okay? So that's part of your homework tonight is understanding VTAC. Now, you're to Google it and look at 20 different rhythm strips of VTAC just so you know what it looks like, okay? It's kind of like when teaching your kids to spell. You can sound out the word cat, k-at, or dog, dog. But the word the was a sight word. You just needed to know it when you saw it. You can't sound it out. VTAC, I want you to be able to look at it and just know VTAC. You have to start there. Now, CPR artifact, not a big deal, but when you're doing compressions, you'll see a waveform looking like the rhythm strip in front of you now. Now, and looking back at our colored portion of the EKG, pink, once again, is atrial contraction or atrial depolarization. Orange is the ST segment. It's the impulse traveling from the SA node to the AV node. Yellow is a QRS complex, which suggests ventricular contraction. Green is the ST segment. It's critical, critical, critical to identify ischemia and infarction. We're going to talk to you about how to draw that baseline that you have to be 99% consistent with. And the blue is ventricular recharging or ventricular repolarization. So again, the pink portion is the P wave. It helps identify sinus rhythm. If you don't see a P wave, it's probably not sinus rhythm. Consider AFib, junctional rhythm, or VTAC. Orange is the PR segment. It's a time from the SA node to the AV node. Normal is 0.12 to 0.20 seconds. Okay? Now, three small boxes to five small boxes. If it's long, it's a first degree heart block. If it's short, it suggests WPW. Now, ladies and gentlemen, know that one small box on the EKG rhythm strip on the horizontal axis represents 0.04 seconds. There's small boxes and big boxes. Small box is 0.04 seconds. The big box is five of them, which is 0.2 seconds. You have to know those measurements. There's no way that you can proceed with really understanding EKGs without some rote memorization, and this is one of them, rote memorization. Now, yellow is a QRS complex, which is the ventricular contraction, okay? It best represents the left ventricle retraction because, the left ventricle contraction because that's the bulk, that's the beefy portion of the heart. That's what it really all comes down to is preserving left ventricular function. Normal measurement here, again, you have to know this, is less than three small boxes or less than 0.12 seconds. If it's bigger than three boxes, we call it wide complex, and we're going to talk about that later. There's multiple different causes of a wide complex QRS, but you're going to learn that after this 1 month time frame together. The ST segment, you have to know how to draw a baseline, an isoelectric line, which we'll talk about, and determine is that baseline above or below the ST segment. Okay, that's what you have to identify is there elevations or depressions, and we're referring to the yellow portion there. And then blue is ventricular repolarization. It's a T wave. It's kind of like porridge. That's how we're going to size this up. Is it too hot, too cold, or is it just right? Okay, is it a normal P wave, too big or too small? Now, we'll talk about T waves coming up down the road. Like the first finding of a STEMI or a big fat heart attack is a hyperacute T wave. One of the findings of hyperkalemia is going to refer to the T wave, so we'll talk about that again in a later chapter. Now, your homework tonight is this memorization, ladies and gentlemen. You have to memorize this. Number one, memorize a small box is 0.04 seconds. Number two, a big box is five of them. It's 0.2 seconds. I need you to know that a normal PR segment is 0.12 to 0.20 or 3 to 5 small boxes. And we need to know that QRS complex got to be less than three small boxes. Hey, folks, welcome to the end of our first session. Okay? I promise to give you everything that I have. And I'll promise you one more thing. I will respond to 100% of the questions that are posted on this video. Okay? If you have a question, you don't know it, you will get it answered. But I need something from you. I need you to really be aggressive in your learning. You got to say, hey, okay, I'm committed to this. I'm committed to the process of learning. I'm going to jump on board because a lot of people go through their life with a tremendous gap in their knowledge in EKGs and just kind of go, I didn't get it in school, so I'm going to surrender it and not quite have it. Or I'll read the 12-lead EKG interpretation on the machine. And that's it. Not only leaves a scotoma in your knowledge, like a real black spot, but it doesn't serve your patients. So be engaged. Folks, my name is John Belinsky. My whole goal is to help you maximize your mind, or I simply teach medicine. Wait, you simply teach medicine? Well, I teach medicine simply. Thanks for watching. See you on Friday. We will have these posts Monday and Friday for 4 weeks straight. So stay tuned. Please share any of these videos you share with your friends or you like, you'll get updated. So you won't have to worry about, am I going to miss next week's post? If you share it or you like it, you'll automatically be flagged to it. It'll be put on your wall so you'll see it. So stay tuned, share it, and like it. Thanks for watching.